Music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
It's my pleasure to have as my guest a composer of supreme importance on the American scene. Born in 1909, Elie Siegmeister is darn young. How are you?
Fine. How are you, David?
You were just having a wonderful lunch, you told me, at ASCAP, and your smile is as radiant as always.
Thank you.
You were just put as board again on ASCAP.
I was reelected to the board of directors, yes.
A very important organization in American musical life, which I think the layperson doesn't know much about. Maybe you could say a word or two.
Well, I think ASCAP is wonderful because it protects the rights of the kind of citizen who needs to have his rights protected, namely the composer and the lyric writer, who without ASCAP really couldn't get along in this world.
ASCAP, though, is certainly not an invention of the 19th century, so the American composer until recently really has had problems.
Yes, I would say so. I think that he has had problems. He has other problems outside of ASCAP, but ASCAP does take care of that side of it very beautifully.
That's a fortunate aspect of contemporary life, because the performer is king in a way, not the composer.
That's true.
How does that make you feel?
Well, It's a fact of life, as you say, and it's a realistic thing. I think every composer every once in a while resents the great attention due to someone who does the most brilliant job on the Tchaikovsky Concerto or the Sibelius Concerto or some other work, whereas we feel that, after all, it's the man who wrote the music who made it all possible. We love performers because without them we couldn't exist, but there should be some better balance, perhaps.
And, of course, you are a performer. You were in former years, a conductor frequently.
That's right.
You understand very well and are appreciative of performers.
Absolutely.
Conductors, and as every composer is delighted to have anyone do their music, really.
Anyone, right.
That's right. Even if it's badly done, there is a certain thrill, I imagine.
That's true. The fact is for a certain length of time, for 2 minutes or 20 minutes or an hour sometimes, the people out there are getting your message. They're responding to what you thought up.
Now, you're a famous composer, so you get important maestros to conduct your music. In the past, you've had champions like Metropolis, especially in works of the Americana kind of music, which you've been known for. But we'll get to that later. I want to say that we're going to be hearing a variety of music, because I myself asked you to program this, and I think that you have done a good job, Elie.
Well, thanks, David.
We're going to have three songs of yours. We're going to have an aria from an opera. We're going to have a movement from the Sextet for Brass, Violin Sonata, String Quartet, and the celebrated orchestral work Sunday in Brooklyn, the Coney Island section.
And also Lonesome Hollow.
Why I say this is because these works show you to be more than many people who have labeled you this folkloristic composer. There's the jazz composer. There's the string quartet, which is based on, I believe, Hebraic themes, right?
That's right.
And there's the jazz influence and, of course, the abstract influence you composed in your life, many a concerto and classical sonata format.
Right.
Now, the first song that we'll hear is titled Nancy Hanks. Tell us of this.
Nancy Hanks, of course, was Lincoln's mother, and this was written as part of a group of songs in the early 1940s, which, as you said, showed the folk background. I did Johnny Appleseed and Lincoln and various other more or less traditional themes. They were all my own original music in that folk vein that I developed at that particular point.
Now, in the 40s, many a composer friend of yours was also mining that nationalist ore. Was this something that you almost got together to do, or was it something that happened in history that had to happen because America was a young country without a definite musical past?
It was in the air. It was in the air since the 1930s, when I think the Depression brought a great many artists, not only composers, but also poets and painters and playwrights, to an awareness of the background in the common people of this country. And they felt the need, and I felt the need, to be rooted in that common lore, that tradition, and from which we took off.
This was an exciting time in American musical history, wasn't it?
It was, yes.
Copland and Virgil Thompson and you and Morton Gould and Blitzstein. So many people were contributing to this spirit that it's now a fait accompli. We have an American music, don't we?
Absolutely.
And we're going to hear an example of an American song. And it's Nancy Hanks. And who is singing this?
This is Elizabeth Kirkpatrick of soprano with Ellen Mandel accompanying.
Yes. Oh, this is from that Orion album of
yes.
Totally of your songs.
Yes.
Let's hear it. Soprano, Elizabeth Kirkpatrick, Alan Mandel, pianist, and we heard Elie Siegmeister's song Nancy Hanks. Beautiful performance, Elie.
I think so.
We have another song. It's from a song cycle, Madam to You?
Yes.
Describe this to me.
Well, Laxton Hughes, the black poet, was a lifelong friend, and we wrote many songs together. And this cycle of Langston's dealt with the ordeals with this woman in Harlem who has some low station in life. We never really know what job she has, but she's not making a lot of money, obviously. However, her pride is just as great as anyone else's in this world, and she feels pretty well set up in this world and has a series of conversations, two people talking back and forth, with different individuals who represent sort of the power, the authority, the census man, the landlord, the fortune teller, and so forth. And these little dialogues are characteristic Langston use, and I love them. And I was moved to set the whole thing to music.
Oh, it's a wonderful set. We're going to hear Madam and Census Man.
Right.
Who are the performers here?
Here it's Esther Hines, soprano, and again, Alan Mandel at the piano.
Let's hear Madam and Census Man by my guest, the American composer, Elie Siegmeister. That was the wonderful song Madam and Census Man from the song cycle Madam to You, which was composed by Siegmeister, Langston Hughes, his friend, the black poet, and you wrote 50 songs in your career over 30 years together. That was an amazing feat. Nobody knows that you have written that many songs.
Well, maybe you'll tell them.
Well, we know it now. How many around altogether?
Songs?
Yeah.
Well, I wrote over the years about 200 songs, but I've cast a lot of them out. So we'd say around 100 songs remain.
Now, when you say cast them out, this means that you have decided this is not to enter your catalog.
Right,
Your master catalog.
My catalog is about 100 songs.
I'd love to hear the whole song cycle, Madam, to you, but we don't have time. I want to go through many tastes of the Siegmeister's many styles. Songs of Experience, this is another cycle of yours?
Yes.
We're going to hear what?
We're going to hear the opening, which is the voice of the bard. And, of course, the poems are by the great William Blake, who has been a favorite of mine ever since I was about 14 years old.
Let's hear it now. Who is the singer here?
The singer is Elaine Bonazzi, and it's the Cantilena Chamber Players with Harry Zarazzi and viola, and the pianist is Frank Glazer.
Here we go.
Past and future.
I've heard The Voice of the Bard from the song cycle Songs of Experience by Elie Siegmeister. And after these messages, we will return with more talk with Siegmeister. And we are back. Elie Siegmeister is my guest. He is taking time out for composing. Now, I say that, of course, as a joke, Elie. You can't be composing all day long. How, though, does it happen that someone composes music, that most mysterious process?
Well, I think I'd be a little insincere if I told you I could explain it in words of modest dimension or long dimension, for that matter.
Well, we've heard three examples of the 200 or so songs in your career. Nancy Hanks was a folkloristic example of our past, our history. Then we had the Madam to You cycle, which is jazz, and we had the very abstract and dramatic quality of The Voice of the Bard. Here we can understand the inspiration coming from the text. What happens when you read poetry? Do you always think of it as a possibility for a future composition? Is something going on? I'm very curious about that.
Every single time.
Uh-huh.
I read a poem, and it, you know, 1 out of 100 or perhaps 500 will strike fire, but I read a lot, and I'll run over to the piano sometimes and go start right in.
You wear glasses, and Franz Schubert, the great songwriter, wore glasses. Now, he was absolutely so insecure that he might lose the melody that he was very nearsighted. He wore the glasses to sleep. Do you ever do that?
No, I didn't do that. I'm afraid I would toss and turn and shatter them.
It was just a bad idea.
No, well, you know, you got to be practical in this world.
There's another example of your art which is really quite well known, not as much in America. You're a big opera composer in Europe. You smile, but that's the truth. In New York, your operas aren't given, but in France and Belgium, they seem to do all right.
Well, I've had some wonderful performances there.
So you've had actual world premieres of operas in Europe, haven't you?
No, actually, all my operas were performed in this country, but I think the biggest performances were in Europe.
I must tell you that I was once myself playing in Shreveport, Louisiana, and afterwards, someone there was very proud to say that, you know, that Shreveport gave a performance of an Elie Siegmeister opera.
They gave the premiere.
Now, you see, They loved that idea.
Oh, I thought it was wonderful. I was so happy to be there. They were my King Ludwig of Bavaria.
Mm-hmm.
Because they not only commissioned an opera, but also an orchestral work and a ballet.
Much happens outside of New York.
That's right. That's right. And particularly to me. I don't know if it happens to other composers as well, but the out there in the country, that's very often my bailiwick.
I want to ask you a question. Many American composers were working like devils during the bicentennial. Commissions were coming their way very well. Has there been a back-off to this? Are you being commissioned as much?
Well, unfortunately, there was a drop in interest. It's more or less in the cards that when you make a big issue out of something and it gets a lot of media hype and intensity, then after a while there's the reaction against it. And I think that it happened this way, too. Everyone got very excited about American music. And, well, now we've had enough of that. Let's do something else.
Let's go back to the old masters.
Let's go back to Mahler, Bruckner, Sibelius, and so forth.
Mahler's doing very well, isn't he?
Oh, he's doing fine in America, yeah.
Well, let's hope your four symphonies do well also.
There are five, David.
There are five?
Yep.
You are working hard. I'm not
I didn't mean
date.
To correct you, but, you know, we might as well set things
it's
straight.
It's quite wonderful. I have one more to look forward to knowing.
Thank you.
Elie, are you doing any big project right now?
Yes, I have two projects on the fire. One is the new opera and another orchestral work.
You love writing operas, don't you?
I really do, and it's a kind of insanity and an addiction with the difficulty it is to get them produced.
Opera writing in 1980 is almost, I can't say funny, because people do it, but it is an amazing thing to comprehend, especially...
I agree with you. Something moves all of us, or some of us who are addicted to it, to do this almost absurd thing. But in my case, I couldn't help it.
Are we now going to hear an aria from one of your operas?
Yes, you're going to hear the opening scene from The Plough and the Stars, which libretto by Edward Mabley, based on the Sean O'Casey play. And in this opening scene, the Irish leader of the Irish uprising, rebels, tells what the uprising is all about.
Mm-hmm. Can we hear it now?
Sure.
Let's hear it.
The sabers in your hands will write the charter of our freedom.
We are.
Across the Irish Sea, on the continent. Battlefield, the nation that fears to shed its blood has lost its manhood. We too must spill the same red wine. Once more shall one
The aria Arms in the Hands from Plough and Stars, an opera by Siegmeister. And you were saying that you were a bug on diction, and I was saying to you, yes, I don't usually concentrate on lyrics, and I understood every word of the three songs that we had on earlier.
Well, that's beautiful, David, and it's a tribute to the singers, and also it's an evidence of my fanaticism on working with them until we get it right. But these singers were all marvelous. Incidentally, the singer in the last excerpt was a tenor named L.D. Clements, and the orchestra was the Hofstra Symphony and chorus conducted by myself.
Wow.
Yeah.
Very fine.
Thank you.
Fun doing it, isn't it?
Oh, it is. Sure. I love it.
Getting out in the performing arena.
Getting out in the performing arena.
In the 40s, you conducted frequently. What's the name of that group?
The American Ballad Singers.
Yes.
Sure. Absolutely. Well, that's where we got started on the diction bit, where every little letter, every D, every click, every consonant, every vowel has to be just in there, because the words in a song or an opera are just as important as the music. For me, for the composer, to say that, but it's true.
So much of it is lost.
Right.
And
it should not be.
I will find our way back to this program right after these messages. Fine. When we will hear a work of yours called Lonesome Hollow.
Good.
My guest, the American composer Elie Siegmeister, and we are going to discuss now, well, we heard the dramatic part of your work in the opera, so we have now heard jazz, we've heard the folklore interest, and we've heard the abstract in the songs of experience, and then we heard the opera composer. What is Lonesome Hollow?
Lonesome Hollow was a work back in that folk period, I think it was written in 1947, in which I transmitted a memory of some walks that I had in West Virginia, in this backwoods country, and the orchestra piece suggests a walker in the hills who was looking for something or just wandering around, and in the central section, hears the sounds of a dance or a village festival in the distance, and then it all breaks off, and he's left back in these lonesome hills, the quiet hills.
How interesting. We now hear Lonesome Hollow by Elie Siegmeister.
Thank you.
Elie, I can actually smell the trails there that you walked on in this work titled Lonesome Hollow. I can smell the air. It's an American work, and you're proud of it. Whenever I hear an American piece, and I'm not speaking of any chauvinism, there is a definite aesthetic there, a definite feeling that, my goodness, this is by an American composer, and it affects me that way. And I doubt that a European orchestra could quite have captured that work as easily as this orchestra, which is not the New York Philharmonic, but what?
It's the Colorado Philharmonic, conducted by Alfred Savia.
Excellent. What is this bit that it is now unfashionable to have any Americana in your music?
I don't know. I think it's a kind of a fashion mongering, a play of certain groups that always have to run to something new. And at a given point, they said, oh, American thing, oh, that's out of fashion. We don't want that. That's old hat. Forget it. In other countries, it goes on for 1,000 years. The French never were ashamed to be French or called what they did a Franchica. The American critics will say, oh, that's Americana. The Germans don't call it Germanica. They just go on writing German music, you know.
Exactly.
And it's a crazy thing that we have in this country.
I believe that we're not yet comfortable with the arts, let's face it. You and Copland grew up in Brooklyn.
That's
he
right.
wrote once a little autobiographical essay,
right.
Composer in Brooklyn.
Right.
It would have all been a different mind concept if you had been walking the streets of Vienna.
Absolutely different, sure. Absolutely different. So why not recognize it?
Exactly. We will be hearing a work of yours, not really of that nature, but much more so within the another very American phase, the jazz context in your sextet for brass.
Right.
Tell me of this work. Do you often write for brass?
No, not really. This was a commission from a group of students at Ithaca College in New York, up New York State, who some years ago wrote me and said they would. They have a brass quintet, and they also have a member of their group who is a percussionist who can play anything, and would I write a sextet for them? So, well, the money was very small, but the idea was delightful, and I wrote this sextet for brass and percussion.
Money aside, the work has survived, and we have a recording of it, and we'll hear the third movement of the Sextet for Brass by Elie Siegmeister. Thank you. just heard a wonderful movement from the brass sextet. Who did that?
Well, it was Gerard Schwartz, trumpet, Ed Birdwell, horn, Alan Dean, second trumpet, Arnold Fromm, trombone, Toby Hanks, tuba, and the wonderful Gordon Gottlieb, who played about 12 percussion instruments all by himself.
Just amazing. After this message, we will return with more music, more discussion by Elie Siegmeister. Well, Elie, we won't be able to talk so much because I have to get in your music, which I think is more important than our words. Let's hear the Violin Sonata, the second movement, and just a brief message about this.
Well, it's my first violin sonata, and it so happens that the second movement has, again, jazz for violin and piano, played, of course, by my daughter Nancy Mandel and her husband Alan Mandel.
Two fine artists. Here is the second movement of Siegmeister's first violin sonata. When was it composed?
1951.
Violin Sonata No. 1 by Elie Siegmeister, and the performers, Alan Mandel and Nancy Mandel. And we will now hear from, what period is the third string quartet from, Elie?
Oh, that's my more recent period. I think that was written in 73.
Now, we're going to hear the second movement about 5.5 minutes. What is the strain here? We had the jazz-oriented sextet and violin sonata.
Something different. I was commissioned to write a string quartet on Hebrew themes, and this whole quartet makes use of certain traditional Hebraic motifs or Jewish motifs, of course, I hope in my own way.
And who's the performers?
This is the Primavera Quartet.
Okay, and that's
the second movement.
I see that's on CRISD 416.
Right. Maybe we'll sell a record.
I hope so.
Good.
Let's hear Elie Siegmeister's second movement from the String Quartet number 3.
Thank you.
a wonderful impact, the second movement of the string quartet on Hebraic. What would you call it? Not motives, of course, but
themes.
Yeah.
Hebrew themes.
This is deep within you, isn't it? This
piece. I think so, yes.
We're going to hear now, Elie, a celebrated piece of yours, as this string quartet certainly has not had time to become. But Sunday in Brooklyn is, and tell me a little of this.
Well, you know, you've played it a number of times, and it's my, when we lived in Brooklyn for many years, our children grew up there, I grew up there, my wife grew up there, and it's part of the fun and the folklore and the life of Brooklyn, and this particular movement tells of Coney Island.
Mm-hmm. So we'll now have Coney Island, and we have Charles Adler, the conductor.
Yes.
And it's the Vienna Symphony, and we have the fifth movement, isn't it, Coney Island, Sunday in Brooklyn, by Elie Siegmeister. Vienna Symphony, Adler conducting, Coney Island Movement of Sunday in Brooklyn. You have made your dent in Americana for sure. The Ozark set you have composed, Wilderness Road, Prairie Legend, Western Suite, which Toscanini did, and all this other music. It's been my pleasure and honor, Elie Siegmeister, to have you as my guest today. And we have much to talk about, and we'll have more programs.
Thank you very much, David.
This is David Dubal. Thank you for listening.
For the love of music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the love of music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.